would not see two speakers instead of one. So I'm very happy I see just one speaker.
Yeah.
We can proceed in a regular way. So it's my pleasure to announce the talk by Abderrahim Antut from Universidad de Chile, joint talk with Rafael Correa and
Marco López.
The title is Weaker Qualification Conditions for Calculus Rules in Convex Analysis and Optimization.
Okay, thank you very much, Rony. First of all, as it is the tradition, I would like to thank very much Lula, Juan, and Javi, who is not here. This is my first time here in Ilche, this year. Yeah? So thank you very much, and good luck for the continuation of this series of conference. I would like to present you one of my research works. This is together with Marco and Rafael Correa from CMM. It is on some qualification condition and formula for calculating the subdifferential of the sum of two convex functions. This is really very basic and very standard in convex analysis. But as we will see, there are still remaining questions. The motivation, this is recent work. We started when Marco visited us in CMM in Chile the last January. But the motivations come from many years ago when we visited with Rafael Marco here in Alicante, and we started working in finding some formula for the subdifferential of the pointwise maximum function or the supremum function. And we observed that some of the idea could be applied even to the rule for the sum. And this is the topic of this talk. Let us present this elementary introduction, and I take part of that in order to present the notation. Yes. When one is interested in minimizing a convex problem, that is a function f defined on a locally convex space, which takes its value in the extended set of real numbers, and the constraints are subjected to this, to that x belongs to a convex set C. One transforms this problem in an unconstrained optimization problem by adding this indicator function, which is equal to 0 on C plus infinity outside. So the minimizer of this new penalized problem is that the point x such that 0 belongs to the subdifferential of the sum. In order to have this decomposition, what we call calculus rule, one needs some qualification condition. Yes? This means that 0 belongs to the sum, the subdifferential of the function f at the point x, given in that classical way, plus the normal cone, which is the subdifferential of the indicator function. This is the first optimality condition, necessary optimality condition. When no qualification condition are presented, one can use the so-called Ehrlich-Phelps formula, which is say the following, that x is a solution of my original problem if and only if, for every epsilon, 0 belongs to the epsilon subdifferential of f at x plus the epsilon or the epsilon subdifferential of the indicator function. Yes? The epsilon subdifferential is defined in this way. So these are the main two formula which exist in the literature. You have a formula for the sum, but you need the result is exact subdifferential calculus, but you need qualification condition. In general, if not, you only have, or we only have, epsilon subdifferential calculus. Yes? There is a way in order to avoid using the epsilon subdifferential passing through the variational principle when the space, the underlying space, is a Banach space. One, instead of taking the epsilon subdifferential, one can consider the exact subdifferential but at nearby point. Yes? So it seems that everything is close. What to do? But let us see, revise what we mean by qualification condition. It is well known, this is a result by Rockefeller in the 70s, that in finite dimension, this when the domain of both function f and g intersect or overlap sufficiently. This means that the interior, the relative interior of their domain intersect. In this case, we have the exact formula. This is very known. This is in finite dimension. This is well defined, the concept of relative interior. In what happens in general for infinite dimensional setting, we have many works by Morrow, Rockefeller, but observe that the condition reads as follows, that there is a point or one of the function is continuous at the domain of the other function. In this case, we also have exact calculus rule. There are other conditions. For example, this one, asking that the cone generated by the difference of the domain is a closed vector space. In this case, also we have exact rule, but this condition requires that the space is Banach, so it is a little bit more restrictive. And as I remembered just before, without any condition, what we have is this formula giving there is this difference. So the formula is characterized the subdifferential of the sum by means of the epsilon subdifferential of the sum of the epsilon subdifferential. There is a gap between the two settings. This is this one. This condition here can be written in this term, that the relative interior of the domain of the first function coincide with the domain of the second one, and vice versa, changing the function. To see this, that take a point in x0 in this set, and another one y0 in the other set, and take the convex combination, and using this accessibility lemma, so this all these segments belong to the intersection of the relative interior. On the other side, the condition in the given by Morrow and extended in general locally convex spaces by Rockefeller, it is only, let us say, one side condition. Yes, here this condition uses both the relative interior of both functions, but here not. Here only. Actually, the second function f could not be continuous everywhere. Yes, so there is this gap between the two settings, finite dimension and infinite dimensional setting. So what we wanted to do with this work is to find, so to extend, to have to suppose such condition, but instead of the interior, using only the relative interior. See? So what we want is to first extend Rockefeller theorem to the general setting. What happens if I only have a part of the condition? The classical condition of Rockefeller asks that this condition, this set is not empty, taking here also the relative interior of the domain of F. So what happens if only I have a part of this condition? What could be the resulting formula? Yes? So this is our analysis also exhibit this family of function, that the cone generated by the epigraph of the function translation is a closed set. This is a larger family than the polyhedral function. Yeah, every polyhedral function satisfies this condition, but not but this is strictly larger family. Yes. And what we, as a consequence of our analysis, we will have this this alternative for representing the subdifferential of the sum by means of the exact subdifferential of some augmented function. Yeah. Instead of having here only f, this is f plus the indicator of some subspace. Yeah. Yes.
Which is a family f of x.
Yes. Actually, for example, it could be finite dimensional subspaces. Yes. But this is not. There are some conditions. Yes. Yes, but this is for if, yes, I at a fixed x, I consider, for example, all subspaces which pass through the point x.
And in the middle,
yes, this is at the point where I want to calculate the subdifferential. Yes? Yes, this is a difference for polyhedral function. This is closed for every point. Yes? But if for this now, only we can think of this the function, the epigraph, which the epigraph is the Lorentz cone. Yes? At zero, this set is closed, but not in at the other point. Yes? I will just, the outline is, first I will just discuss some fact about the lower semi-continuity assumption. In some, we observed in the literature that in some results, there are people who ask lower semi-continuity of the function and others not. So what we want to fix this issue here. Just because we are dealing with infinite dimension, I will also fix what I mean by the interior relative interior of a set. I will give the main result and useful situation. This means an example and an application to an optimization problem. This is the definition of the lower semi-continuous hollow function. We know that for every polyhedral function is semi-continuous, and under this condition, this is the Rockefeller qualification condition. We always have this formula that the closure of the sum is the sum of the closure. So, if I am interested in the subdifferential of the sum, I suppose that it is not empty. If it is not empty, the subdifferential of the sum coincide with the subdifferential of the closure. But since I am supposing this condition, this is equal to the subdifferential of the closure, and now I have only to deal with the lower semi-continuous function. Yes? Since this is just to say that in some result dealing with subdifferential calculus, the lower semi-continuity is hidden within the condition, and in many cases, all this qualification condition is to ensure this property. So, in our final result, this will appear as an hypothesis. Yes. Just to define what we mean by the interior relative interior of a set. It is the interior with respect to the affine variety of the set. Yes, when this set is closed. Otherwise, I just put the empty set. Yes, just to remember to recall that more of the result known for the interior relative in finite dimension are still valid in this more general case, because I am assuming this stronger condition. Yes. Yeah. For example, accessibility lemma we have. Also under this condition, I have this property of lower semi-continuity, and these two are equivalent. But our first starting point is the following, that assuming this closure condition, we have this classical Ariart-Iriti-Phelps formula. The proof is very easy. Just observe that this is the support function of the subdifferential of the sum. Because of that condition, this is the same as this one. I use my condition. This is just the definition of the subdifferential, the directional derivative. I have the equality, and I can, this is less than when I take the epsilon directional derivative. Since my function now are lower semi-continuous, this is just the subdifferential of the epsilon subdifferential. Yes? And I can go back to the original function and arrive here. This is just to say that this set is included in the sum of the epsilon subdifferential for every epsilon. So I have the first inclusion. The other inclusion is automatic. This is the only thing we have to prove this is the known formula of Ariart-Iriti-Phelps. This is, we need for the proof of the main result, we need this geometric lemma. Suppose that we have a family of convex set which decreases as epsilon goes to zero. Yes. Consider a convex set C and assume the following, that the quotient generated by C minus X is closed, or this this condition here, that the domain of the support function intersect the interior relative of C minus X. So I have this condition. What does this mean? If I take the intersection over epsilon of this set, I can take the limit on epsilon here. Yes? This is technical lemma, but you can see it using the function. If I have the sum of a given convex function and an indicator one, yes, I can, using this, I can write this subdifferential as in that form. Instead of taking here the epsilon subdifferential of the indicator, I have the exact normal cone. But this is the main result. What I suppose this semi-continuity property, yes, if the function are semi-continuous, we are okay, and assume the following. For example, this condition, this is a half of what? Remember that the Rockefeller condition asks this is now empty for the relative interior of both function. Here we only ask a part of the condition, but since we are in infinite dimension, we need this condition more, that the function G, which appears with its relative interior, is continuous when restricted to the affine of the domain of G, is continuous on the relative interior of its domain. Yeah? We saw with Marco this morning that this property also appears in this function referred as to quasi-continuous. Yes?
Quasi-continuous.
But there is this condition more, that this is that the affine of the domain is of
the codimension
is finite. But here we don't need. We only need this condition of continuity. Of course, if we are in finite dimension, this is obvious. This holds. This always holds. Yes, and what about this other? So this is alternative, no? If I have this, this is just to say to extend what is known for polyhedral function. Yes, this means that if my function G is somewhat polyhedral, or it satisfies this property, then here is the formula which is between. It is at some intermediate level of generality between here only appear the exact subdifferential of the function G. Remember that the Ariart-Iriti-Phelps, here we have the epsilon subdifferential. Yes?
And the quite lower semi-continuity.
Require of, yes. So the function which gives me, which is somewhat caliphate function, appears only with its exact subdefinition. Yeah. Of course, if, for example, the subdefinition of this function is empty, here I will have the exact formula. Yes. Yes. Perhaps this is not nor the proof, because I will not have time. How much time I have time? 10 minutes. Yes. Yes. I will not enter in the. So this is other. So what we want is, if in general, if I don't have this condition on the function g. So what we want, a way to avoid this is to consider this family of function. Here I write, because it depends on the point x and on function f and g, and I consider all finite dimensional subspaces which contain x and such, and with this, and which satisfy exactly my condition. Yes? So I mean that I want to apply my formula or my previous theorem with the function g plus the indicator function. Yes, this is the domain of g plus the indicator function of L. So the problem is that this family may be empty. For example, consider this case here. The function, so consider this, the function, yes, the indicator function of R plus, yes. If, so there is here, there is no way to get this Hausdorff space which satisfy this property. Yes, but for example, if the domain of f and g meets each other in a point which is different of x, for example, this Hausdorff space, yes, belong to this family. Yes, and considering this function, this family of subspaces, what we do is to apply, because we know that I can write this. Yes, and we choose the subspace L, such that this function now I call GL satisfy the required condition of my theorem. Yes? And arriving at that point, yes, we can apply the theorem. The g is just n epsilon, the epsilon subdifferential of f at x, plus the subdifferential of this function. Yes? And here, this is a kind of rule where only appear the exact subdifferential of this function g. Yeah. This is a special situation where the second function is polyhedral, it satisfies this closure condition, and so I can apply my formula. Yeah. If the second function is also polyhedral, we have the exact, and this is well-known result of Rockefeller. Now what we want is also to get the exact subdifferential here. What we have to do is just ask this kind of qualification on both function f and g. Actually, this each one of these condition allow to have this formula here. For example, that one of the function f has this cone closed, for example polyhedral, and satisfy this qualification condition, or both of functions satisfy this closure condition. Yes, or which resemble more to the what is known by Rockefeller, that the relative interior of both function is now empty. And since we are in infinite dimension, we ask that this continuity assumption. Yes. Of course, if I am in Rn, this is automatically holds. Yes. What we obtain is we can avoid this epsilon. Yes. There is no need for epsilon here. So there is no need for this epsilon here. But the problem is, remember that we have the closure before. Yes. And this is not exactly what is, it is not exactly the statement of Rockefeller or Monroe formula. But we know that if, for example, we suppose that one of this set is locally bounded, we can get rid of this closure. So what we obtain now is an extension of Rockefeller theorem, but the resulting formula is by means of this closure. Yeah, and we are still working to avoid this closure in the formula. This is an alternative. So here, instead of taking the epsilon subdifferential, we take the exact subdifferential, but of this function FL and GL. FL is this is the function, the sum of the function with the indicator function of subset L. This the same as before. We take the finite dimensional subspaces which contain X, and satisfy now one of these three conditions. Yes, for instance, this one, that the relative interior of the domain of FL and the domain of GL intersects. Since we are considering finite dimension, this is the usual relative interior. So I don't need here this continuity assumption or this second alternative. And the conclusion is similar in appearance to the Ehrhardt-Phelps formula, but using this augmented function. Yeah. And with the convention that when this, because this family may be empty, when it is empty, we consider as this set the whole space X star. Yes. Let us just discuss a useful situation, which is the following. I consider what I want is the subdifferential of this sum, the sum of a convex function with a composite function, convex with a linear operator, A. I suppose that A is continuous, having a continuous adjoint, and I consider two convex functions, F and G, from X to Rn. Now, what happens is that G, because it is, so if we want to apply the Rockefeller formula, one needs this condition. Relative interior of domain of G intersect the relative interior or the range or the image of domain of F by A. Yes. Just to say that this can be simplified when the space, Banach space, the space is separable Banach spaces, just considering the quasi-relative interior. Yeah. And this condition, it is more easier than this one. Yeah. What we can do with our analysis is replace the previous condition by means of this one. Now the function G, the F is defined on infinite dimension space, locally convex space. The function G is defined in Rn, so its relative interior makes sense in the usual way. So if we ask this simple condition that the image of the domain of F by A intersect the interior relative of domain of G, we have this formula here. Yes, and only the function G only appears with its exact subdifferential. So here, what is the advantage of that is that we are putting together the finite and the infinite dimensional case. Of course, we can get rid of this epsilon by using variational principle. Yes, and if we are in a Banach space, we can, and function g satisfy one of these two conditions, I can represent each subdifferential by means of the sum. Yes, the limit of sum of subdifferential, but here only fixing the point of the first function, the function g, which yes, and perhaps yes, 2 minutes. If we want to apply the previous result on this optimization problem, we saw this morning with Marco, considering an infinite programming problem. I minimize a convex function under this infinitely many constraint Ft, with x belong to C. T is arbitrary. Yes, this is the standard form of infinite programming problem. And we assume that the problem is feasible, and this standard assumption that the cone generated by the convex hull of the union of the epigraph is closed. Yes, because we are dealing with infinitely many constraint. This is just to say that sigma, or the system sigma, is Farkas-Minkowski. So we suppose that this set is closed. We assume that this set is closed, and here we assume that this is the feasible set, which is convex, that the relative interior of the feasible set intersects the domain of F. In general, what is needed is that here we also must have the relative interior. So we are relaxing the condition, and the conclusion is that is this Kakati condition, where the constraint only appear with the exact subdifferential. Yeah. So this is the reference. Thank you very much.